प्रपन्न पारिजाताय तोत्र वेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः ओम। डियर फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू द स्टडी ऑफ गीता। वी आर कमिंग टू द एंड ऑफ द 10th चैप्टर। वी आर सीइंग द श्लोक नंबर 37 ऑफ 10th चैप्टर, दैट इज विभूति योग। And we have been seeing that Lord Krishna is describing various vibhutis. Vibhuti means a glorious manifestation of that Supreme Reality. The Supreme Being, we know that Supreme Being is something which is formless, nameless, something which is called Brahman, which is of the name of infinitely, which can be described as infinitely existing consciousness. It has no form, no shape, it is not even a person. So whereas in that Supreme Consciousness, there is this ability to manifest. And that manifesting power is called Prakriti, it is called Maya, it is called Pradhanam, it is called in so many names. And in that manifesting ability, we have got this concept of Ishvara, the omniscient, omnipotent, that is something which is the controller of the whole universe. So we are, and that manifesting, then that controller of the universe is manifesting in so many forms. That was what we call that cosmic being. It is manifesting in so many forms among humans, among gods, among rishis, among even among the sages, and even among insentient things like mountains, rivers, etc. And it is also manifesting as certain abstract concepts like Vidya, Kirti, Shrihi, Hrihi, etc. All these great qualities, they are also manifestations of the divine. So like that he has been describing. And in that context, we are seeing the shloka, Vrushninam Vasudevosmi. Vrushninam Vasu, I explained this line. I will briefly explain again. Vrushni, that is shloka number 37. Vrushninam Vasudevosmi, Pandavanam Dhananjayaha, Muninam Apyaham Vyasaha, Kavinam Ushana Kavihi. So, Vrushninam, in that clan belonging to that Vrushnis, that is the name, it is the name of a particular clan, like Surya Vamsham, Chandra Vamsham, etc. That is Vrushni Vamsham. In that Vamsha, I am that Vasudeva. So he is not referring to himself. In that Vamsha, I am that, he is not saying. Which means that Lord Krishna is speaking from a much higher position. Though he is in the physical personality called Vasudeva, he is speaking from a much higher position, that is as the spokesperson of that Supreme Reality. So that is what we have to see here. He is not saying, I am that. He is not, instead of saying that, I am Vasudeva among Vrushnis. I am Dhananjaya among Pandavas. I am among Ramaha, Shastrabhrutamvaraha, among all the great archers, I am Rama. So like that he is telling in third person, even while referring to himself. He is referring to himself in third person. Vrushninam Vasudevosmi, Pandavanam Dhananjaya. I was also saying how there is a debate, or rather disagreement, as to who is the hero of Mahabharata. So some people say it is Krishna, some people say it is Dharmaraja, some people say particularly the Madhva sect, they say that it is Bhima, and some others say it is Arjuna. So anyway, whatever it is, but here Krishna is saying, among the Pandavas, I am Dhananjaya, I am that Arjuna, because we are aware of the two great saints called Naranarayana. Naranarayana, in fact, Narayana is said to be the very avatar of Supreme Being, Supreme Narayana. So, Nara and Narayana, Nara is said to be that Arjuna, Narayana is said to be that Supreme Vishnu. So, Pandavanam Dhananjayaha. Now, this line we have to see. Muninam Apyaham Vyasaha. Muninam, among all the people, among the people, Rushi. Rushi, we know the word Rushi and also Muni. Muni, the etymological meaning of Muni is Manana Shilaha. That is, a person who has got that contemplative ability, a person who has that ability to contemplate. All the people do not have that ability to contemplate. Only some people, whom we call rishis, sages. In English, much simpler word is a thinker. In fact, thinkers and philosophers are very few. We are all people who borrow ideas from others. We just borrow ideas from others and then repeat those ideas, and then our knowledge, sometimes quite often, the knowledge of the so-called very great people, the knowledge of very highly learned people, a highly learned people, person may sometimes be somebody who has got a knowledge of so many ideas of so many people, but he doesn't have any knowledge of his own. But there are people who also think, and evolve some new ideas. So these are the people who are called thinkers. But now, in the case of Muni, what are they contemplating on? They are contemplating on the Supreme Reality. So this Muninam Aham Vyasa. And Vyasa is somebody, the name Vyasa is also interesting. Vyasa means to elaborate. There is a word called Samasa. Samasa means to contract. That is, there are 2, 3, 4 words, suppose. All these 2, 3, 4 words you are contracting into one expression. Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata, Shatrughnaha. To include Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata and Shatrughna. And for example, Dharma, Artha, Kama, Mokshaha. Dharma, Artha, Kama and Moksha, all those 4 things are put together in one word. All that collectively becomes one word. And it is also declined like one word. So, that is called Samasanam. That is, Samasam is contracting so many things. Vyasam is to elaborate. Of course, here we are not talking about elaborating the words and all that. We are talking about the way in which Vyasa divided all the Vedas correctly. Prior to Vyasa, it seems Vedas were all in a jumbled up condition. And Vyasa examined them, their nature, and then he categorized them, and then he put all these ruk suktas, that is metrical compositions, in one particular branch called Rigveda. And metrical compositions, how they are used in various yajnas, all these yajna kriya, that is how one has to perform yajna, the procedures of yajna, etc., all those things, both chandas and also gadhyam. Gadhyam is prose. So all that put together we see in Yajurveda. Samaveda again takes some more mantras from the same Rigveda, and again they are sung in the forest. And Vyasa is also said to have developed another Veda called Atharva Veda. Of course, he didn't write on his own. He has not written on his own. Whatever mantras were already there, he picked up some of them. And then he said, okay, these things for various mundane purposes. For example, a king is getting coronated, for example. So if the king is getting coronated, you have to invoke all the powers of all the gods into that king. So for that, okay, you select this mantra, you select that mantra, and then you say, okay, you are invoking the power of Vishnu. You are invoking the power of, not Vishnu, of course, Agni. You are invoking the power of Indra. You are invoking the power of Varuna. You are invoking the power of somebody else, for example, Soma. So like that, you are doing all those things. Or maybe a king is going out on an expedition. Let us say, expedition means Vijayayatra. Vijayayatra is... He is going to conquer somebody. In olden days, they used to take a huge army and then they used to start off. And at that time, the Purohitas, they do perform some yajnas. So for that specific purpose, so it is something like a custom-made thing. So all those custom-made things you can see in Atharva Veda. So like that, he divided them. And he also elaborately wrote commentaries on what is called Brahma Sutras. He wrote the Brahma Sutras. So like that, he elaborated. He elaborated what was there, and then in a very systematic manner, he divided the Vedas. So that is the reason why he is called Vyasa. And Vyasa also, we know that he has written this Mahabharatam, which is also called the Panchama Veda, the fifth Veda. Mahabharata is almost given that equal footing along with the Vedas. Mahabharata Vedan Adhyapayamasa, Mahabharata Panchaman, there is a line in the Mahabharata itself, along with the 4 Vedas and Mahabharata, which is the 5th one. So that is, Mahabharata is considered to be the 5th Veda. So he is such a great man, and Vyasa is also, that Mahabharata is such a huge composition, that Vyasa, in a very challenging way, he says, whatever is here, you find in the world. Whatever is not here, it is not there in the world. Which means, whatever all the human actions, all types of human feelings, all types of human emotions, all types of human problems, dilemmas, Rajaniti means statecraft, and philosophical arguments, all those things, what all you want to see, it is all there. It is almost like an encyclopedia of human nature. So that is how Vyasa makes a challenging statement. So that is how Muninam Apyaham Vyasaha. Then Kavinam Ushana Kavihi. Kavinam, kavi, usually we refer to a poet. That is, the established meaning of the word kavi is a poet. But here, it is not as though it is talking about poets like Valmiki, say Kalidasa, or Bhavabhuti, or Shakespeare, Milton, etc. He is talking about the wise people. In fact, kavi is also an adjective used for the supreme reality. Kavi, the etymological meaning of kavi is krantadarshi, that which is able to see everything, that which is able to know everything. Of course, we are not talking about the supreme Brahman, because in that supreme Brahman there is no question of knowing. Knowing comes only at a lower level. Only when I am finite in nature, I know things. When I am infinite, there is no question of knowing, there is no knower known relationship in that. So in that, kavi is krantadarshi. Krantadarshi means he knows that particular, he knows the past, the present and the future, everything it is known to that. So that is what is called kavi. And kavinam ushana kavihi. And among all the wise people, among all the people who are enlightened, I am that Shukracharya. So Ushana refers to Ushana, the meaning of Ushana is that Shukracharya, who incidentally or funny, ironically, he is not somebody who is a teacher of gods, he is the teacher of the demons. In fact, in Mahabharata, there is one statement in the very beginning of Mahabharata, that the teacher of all the gods is Brihaspati, and the teacher of the demons is Shukracharya. And naturally, we expect some clash between Brihaspati and Shukracharya. Brihaspati is the chief of the priest, or rather the teacher of gods, and Shukracharya is the teacher of the demons. Naturally, we expect a fight. But Mahabharata says that Shukracharya or the Brihaspati, whatever you say, by his yogic power, he formed into two bodies. One person formed into two bodies. One person was the god's teacher, that is Brihaspati, and the other person is Shukracharya, who is the teacher of the demons. So why did he divide himself? That is, he wanted to lead the demons in such a way that they will be vanquished. They will be finally vanquished by the gods. So that seems to be the strategy. That is what we find. So this Shukracharya is also a person who is said to have known what is called Mruta Sanjeevani Vidya. Here, of course, we will just take a break and resume. Let us resume. One more thing about Shukracharya is that he is a man who knows that Mruta Sanjeevani. That is, when there is a fight between the gods and demons, the demons were just dying. And whenever the demons died, this man was again reviving them, bringing them back to life. So that is called Mruta Sanjeevani Vidya. That is again a long story in Mahabharata. I will not go into that story. So Shukracharya was supposed to be a very, very eminent person. So Kavinam Ushana Kavihi. Then we come to the next shloka, that is 38th shloka. Dando Damayatam Asmi Niti Rasmi Jigishatam Maunam chaivasmi guhyanam jnanam jnanavatamaham. Here again four things are told. That is, dandaha damayatam asmi. The first line is, among all the things which control people, which control or which enforce or which regulate or which discipline people, I am that danda. We know the meaning of danda. Danda usually means a stick. In Hindi also we call it danda. The Sanskrit word danda. In Telugu also we use the word dandam. Dandam is a stick. Dandam tachakunam bhavetu is a danda. In Hindi we call it danda. So danda is, what is that danda? Danda is not the physical stick. Suppose a policeman is carrying a lathi, and a policeman is carrying, let us say, a baton. In English we have to call it baton. In lathi is a Hindi word. Suppose a policeman is carrying a gun or a baton. So that is symbolic of the power of law. It is not policeman's power, it is the power of law. It is the power which the people have given to him. He has not got it by him, he is not doing it on his own. The power to the policeman has been given by the people only in order to discipline those who are bad. So that is danda. So the strong arm of law, the power of law, that is what is called danda. In fact, the kings, they were also trained in what is called danda niti. How to punish the bad people. Dandaniti, a king is supposed to know what is called Dandaniti. A king was supposed to know Anvikshaki, Trayi, Varta and Dandaniti. Anvikshaki is logic, Trayi means the Vedas, and also then again Varta, that is economics, that is how to improve the economy of the state. and also Dandaniti, how to punish bad people, jurisprudence, both civil jurisprudence and also criminal jurisprudence, a king was supposed to know. So this Dandodamayata Vasmi, that is what we call the strong arm of law, and sometimes we call the long arm of law. So this Danda, in fact, there are certain Subhashitas also, Danda Supteshu Jagarti. When we are all asleep, what is it that is keeping awake? It is the law which is keeping awake. Dandaha Supteshu Jagarti. When all the people are sleeping, happily you are sleeping, but law is awake in the sense that whatever, if there is something wrong goes on, it is the law again which catches those people and punishes those people. So in that sense, in a figurative way, that Danda, though it is an abstract noun, that is jurisprudence, let us say, that Danda, the law, the arm of law, is something which is controlling the people, which is controlling the people and putting some order, sense of order in the people. Then the second line is, Niti Rasmi Jigishatam. Jigishatam means, among all those things which want to conquer. Jigisha means Jetum Icha, that is the desire to conquer, desire to win, desire to achieve. Not only achieve, desire to win. Jigisha is Jetum Icha, desire to win. So that, what is that, if you have the desire to win, what should you have? You should have a strategy. In any war, there are two words called strategy and tactics. Suppose there is a war. In that war, you should have a broad strategy, you should have a broad plan of action. In that broad plan of action is called a strategy. And again, when you have got a broad plan of action, there are some details, minor details. Suppose you have to attack this particular place on a particular date. You have to attack some other place on some other date. And then you have to cut off the enemy forces here. Suppose you are thinking on those lines. And that is called tactics. Suppose you want to attack this particular place, how much strength is needed and how you have to go about and what time you have to go there and how you have to stop the enemy. And all those things, that is called tactics. But broad thing is broad strategy. Broad strategy is, okay, when you are hitting in one direction, you appear as though you are hitting in the other direction. So that is a strategy. But then the details are called tactics. So that is called a niti. Niti is niti rasmi jigishatam. If you want to win a war, you should have that strategy. So that is one meaning. The other meaning is niti also means nyaya shastra. What we call nyaya. Nyaya is the logic. Niti rasmi jigishatam. Suppose there is a debate. In a debate, you should have that knowledge of logic in order to win that debate, in order to establish your point in that debate. Nitirasmi jigishatam. Then, maunam chaivasmi guhyanam. Guhya is what? We have come across this word in 9th chapter, in the very beginning of 9th chapter. Idam tute guhyatamam. Pravakshyam yanasuyave, that was the line. Idam tute guhyatamam pravakshyam yanasuyave, the 9th chapter, the very first line. Guhya is something which deserves to be protected. Something which desires to be very well understood and protected. You can protect something only when you understand the thing properly. I was telling you, in olden days, there were no books. So if you want to protect a particular knowledge, you have to meditate on that, you have to think and you have to absorb and then you have to internalize that particular knowledge. Unless you internalize, you will lose it. Suppose the guru says something, you have to contemplate on that. That is the reason why even today in traditional schools, suppose you have got a class today and you have to do some chintanam on that. Chintanam, and the very next day you have to almost repeat. What all the teacher has told. So unless you remember what all the teacher has told on the previous day, the next lesson will not move. So that is how in the traditional schools, even today the system is there. But now of course, nobody follows in the modern schools. So but here, maunam chaivasmi guhyanam. Guhya is something which is gopaniya, something which has to be protected. If the knowledge has to be protected, you have to properly meditate on that. Unless you meditate on that, you cannot you can't protect it. So that which protects, that which deserves to be protected, has to be protected by proper meditation on that. So maunam, usual meaning of the word maunam is, okay, so and so is mauna pradarshana, suppose, let us say. Maunam is something, okay, they don't make any noise. Noiseless situation is what is called usually maunam. But here, maunam, we have to take in Vedanta, whenever we say maunam, We are not talking about physical silence. We are not talking about that noiseless situation. We are talking about the ability to think. We are talking about that power of contemplation. So unless you contemplate, contemplation is something which is a very, very powerful tool for knowledge, very powerful tool for attaining that what is called Atmajnana. So without contemplation, one will not attain that Atmajnana. So Maunam Jaivasmi Guhyanam, then Jnanam Jnanavatamaham, Jnanam. And here, of course, Jnanam is referring to that knowledge of oneness of Jiva and Atma. Knowledge of, in Vedanta, the final message or the ultimate message of Vedanta is that what you call Jiva is just if you negate all these limitations, all the limitations which the Jiva is imposing on himself, in reality, what remains is that supreme reality only, manifesting in this antahkarana. And this gentleman, he is feeling that he is so and so, he is X, Y, Z, etc. He belongs to this country, he belongs to this religion, he belongs to this caste, etc., etc. But when you negate all these delimiting things, then what remains is that Jiva is nothing different from that Brahman. So that is what is the knowledge here. Jnanam Jnanavatamaham. Among all the wise people, I am that Jnanam. So this is again a very interesting thing. Then the next shloka is almost concluding. Remember our Krishna here, in the 39th shloka, he is concluding. He says, Yachapi sarvabhutanam bijam tadaham arjuna natadasti vinayatsyat maya bhutam characharam. So, yachapi sarvabhutanam bijam. Whatever is that bija. Bija means what? Bija is the seed. I am the seed for all the things. What does it mean? That is, when we say bijam, that word bija is used usually to refer to what is called that cosmic manifestation, the first cosmic manifestation. In the very beginning, I told you that the supreme reality is what is called satyam jnanam anantam, that is, which is of the nature of consciousness only, pure consciousness. In that pure consciousness, there is a manifestation. Some a sudden manifestation, and in that it is somewhat like a huge wave in a ocean, and that wave suddenly thinks, yes, I have got a particular shape. Wave forgets temporarily that it is ocean, and wave thinks that, yes, I have got a particular shape, I have got a particular form, etc. So that notion of I in that pure consciousness, that is called the cosmic being, or it is called Ishvara also. And Ishvara in some other context is also called Hiranyagarbha. So that Ishvara, with that cosmic form, that is what is called the Chaitanyam, which is associated with this Maya. Pure consciousness, which is associated with the creative power. The pure consciousness associated with this creative power is the Bijam, that is the seed for the entire manifestation. Because from that thing only, all other things are manifesting. All the beings, all the sentient beings, insentient beings, and also what we call the panchabhutas, prithivi, apas, tejo, vayu, akasha. What are the five elements? That is earth, water, fire, air and space. Earth means we are not only referring to this earth, we are also referring to what all hard substances are there, all the planets all over the universe, all these stars all over the universe, we are referring to all that. Prithivi, apas, tejo, vayu, akasha. We are referring to all that. We are not only referring to this earth. So, sarvabhutanam bijam, I am the bijam for all these panchabhutas also. And from those five elements only, all these things are originating. From those five elements only, all the insentient things are there, and the sentient things are also originating from that, because in those five elements, we have got what is called the sattva guna, rajoguna and tamoguna. And from that sattva guna, we are getting all these sense organs and the mind. Rajoguna, you are getting this energy body, what is called prana. And tamoguna, you are getting the physical body, just physical body, which is blood, bones, flesh, etc. So this is the evolution. This is a sort of something which has evolved from the five elements. So sarvabhutanam bijam, that is, I am the karanam, or the cause for this whole universe, which is called karyam. Karyam and karanam are two words we see in any shastra. Karyam means the effect, that which has come into being. Karanam is the cause for that. So whatever is karyam, it has not newly come. It is there already in the karyam, in the karanam. That karanam only manifests as the karyam. So like a pot is not different from a clay. Pot is not different from clay because clay is the karanam and pot is the karyam. So similarly, that consciousness, consciousness associated with that manifesting power, mayopadikam chaitanyam it is called. So consciousness associated with that manifesting power is the bijam, that is the karanam, and the whole universe is the karyam. So you and I, we are all karyam. You and I, we are not different from that, because the karyam is not different from karanam. So you and I, we are not different from that, our original bijam. The original bijam, we are not different from that. So that is the point here. Yachapi sarvabhutanam bijam tadaham. I am that bijam. In fact, I am that supreme, that consciousness. Then na tadasti vina yat syat. That is, maya vina yat syat. That which can exist without me. This is the maya vina yat syat na tadasti, which means, for those who want to know the Sanskrit anvaya, maya vina yat syat na tadasti means there is that which can exist without me, that which can exist without me is not there anywhere. That means I am the bijam. Without this bijam there cannot be anything. Without this karanam there is no karyam. Maya yat syat maya bhutam characharam, whether it is sentient thing or insentient thing, all the things, they exist only because of me, because I am the karyam. I am the karanam, I am the cause for all the beings. Then we come to the last 2-3 shlokas. That is, nantosti mama divyanam vibhutinam parantapa yeshat uddeshatah prokto vibhuter vistaromaya. This is the 40th shloka. I think we'll take it up tomorrow, because Krishna is making a categorical statement here that there is no end to my vibhutis. I have only told you by way of sample, I have told you a few. And I cannot recount all the things, because it is endless. So that is what he is going to say. We will see this tomorrow. Harihi Om Tat Sat.